Welcome to Sound Bites, hosted by registered dietitian nutritionist Melissa Joy Dobbins. Let's delve into the science, the psychology, and the strategies behind good food and nutrition.
Hello, and welcome back to the Sound Bites podcast. Today's episode is about inflammation and anti-inflammation diets. I'm talking with two registered dietitians and cookbook authors, Serena Ball and Carolyn Williams. Serena Ball is a registered dietitian, food writer, and co-author of the best-selling The 30-Minute Mediterranean Diet Cookbook and the newly released Easy Everyday Mediterranean Diet Cookbook, 125 Delicious Recipes from the Healthiest Lifestyle on the Planet. And Carolyn is a culinary nutrition expert, dietitian, author, and a 2017 James Beard Journalism Award winner who is known for her ability to simplify the science behind healthy eating. In 2019, she released Meals That Heal, 100-plus everyday anti-inflammatory recipes in 30 minutes or less, a cookbook that teaches readers how to use the healing powers of food in quick, family-friendly recipes to improve overall health. Welcome to the show, ladies.
Thanks for having us.
It's great to have you both on and talking about such an important topic that we're hearing more and more about inflammation, but I don't know that a lot of people really understand what it is. And before we jump into that topic, though, I would love for both of you to share a little bit more about your backgrounds and the work that you currently do. So, Serena, why don't we start with you?
Sure. So I live in St. Louis. Actually, I live outside of St. Louis a little bit in southern Illinois, but that's the closest airport that I sometimes fly out of, not lately.
Right.
I also write for foodnetwork.com, and I have several other articles and publications that I write for, including the Academy's Food and Nutrition Magazine. And I have a column in there with my co-author, Deanna Seagrave Daly, that we call Healthy Kitchen Hacks. And it's been running now for 5 years. I can't believe it. But that's where we share cooking tips, shortcuts, and sort of fun tips for being in the kitchen with other fellow dietitians through the Academy's Food and Nutrition Magazine. I also do some TV locally, and I mostly just love to cook and develop recipes in my kitchen for my husband and my four kids.
Wonderful. I'm so glad you mentioned your co-author and your business partner, Deanna Seagrave Daly. She was on the podcast way back in episode 51, doing healthy kitchen hacks. And the three of us go way, way, way back to the mid-2000s when we all worked for the Dairy Council. So I'm thrilled to have you on the show and sad that you moved away from Chicago years ago and you've been down in St. Louis area. We miss you around here. And maybe when we get back to traveling again, I will see you.
Sounds good.
But welcome to the show. And Carolyn, tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Yeah, I'm Carolyn Williams, and I live in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. I'm a registered dietitian, as you already mentioned, and I am faculty at the local community college here where I teach culinary arts and nutrition. But where I spend most of my time is with content writing, recipe development, working on projects for different media outlets, as well as some of my own projects, like cookbooks. Mm-hmm. I've got my next one, One Dish, Meals That Heal, coming out in November of 2021. So I'm busy with that. And I also have a limited series podcast that's launching in this spring called Happy Eating that I'm doing along with a fellow dietitian and colleague, Briarly Horton, who is the former food nutrition director for Cooking Light magazine. Mm-hmm. And we explore the connection between food and mental wellness. So I'm looking forward to getting that launched.
Excellent. Thank you. Oh, very interesting and exciting projects. So, okay, let's dive into the topic of inflammation. Carolyn, your book, Meals That Heal, really talks a lot about what inflammation is, what causes it. So I'd love to start with you to kind of set the stage, and then we're going to kind of transition into, you know, how do we put this into practice and the Mediterranean diet, which is Serena's book, really is one of the gold standard diets, if you will. So let's start with Carolyn. What is inflammation and what causes it?
Okay. So inflammation, and I have to be honest, inflammation really wasn't something on my radar 5 or 6 years ago. But I wrote an article on Alzheimer's for Cooking Light magazine a while back. And when I dove into the research, I realized that inflammation was driving the progression of this. And I started to also realize in other content pieces that I was working on a variety of different topics, weight loss, autoimmune conditions, heart health, diabetes, I started seeing the word inflammation in all of these. And I realized that inflammation is a key player in really the progression of all major chronic conditions, or most all of them. That's what really made me dive into it. So inflammation is not technically a bad thing. It is a healthy reaction by the immune system, or at least the way it was designed. Acute or good inflammation is a healthy immune response. It's responding to a bacteria or maybe a bruise or a cut. And you see the inflammation, like maybe when you have a paper cut on your finger and it gets kind of red and it's painful, that's inflammation coming to the rescue to help heal your finger, and then it will slowly dissipate. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly how it's supposed to work. So then it goes away. Chronic inflammation is when you develop some inflammation within your body and it doesn't go away. It's more of a low-grade, low-level immune system response that doesn't go away until you do something to shut it off. But the problem is there really are no major overt symptoms. There's only subtle ones until, you know, diseases progress to maybe where you get a diagnosis of type 2 diabetes or heart disease or something like that. But it can slowly build on itself. I tell people to kind of think of like initial inflammation as like a small little fire in your body. It doesn't really bother you that much. And like that small fire might be a little bit of insulin resistance. And maybe you're carrying a little bit of extra weight. Just kind of like how you are like on a maybe a day at the office, or when we used to go to the office, a day at work, when something happens that just kind of irritates you. Kind of, you know, the rest of the day, you're just a little bit heightened. It's easier for stuff to kind of get under your skin and kind of irritate you a little more. That's kind of what having a little bit of inflammation is like in your body. So when you have a little bit of inflammation starting in your body, maybe you're seeing it through insulin resistance or weight gain, then that makes you a little more prone. You're a little more susceptible to other forms of inflammation developing. And slowly this can build until maybe you have a diagnosis of type 2 diabetes or some kind of larger condition that really gets your attention.
Okay. Yeah. So you mentioned type 2 diabetes. What are the associated diseases or ailments that seem to result from this chronic inflammation?
Yeah. Well, it's really pretty much everything. You've got all of your cardiovascular diseases and conditions, heart attack, stroke, hypertension, and your metabolic ones. So obesity, metabolic syndrome, type 2 diabetes. You've also got your neurological ones. Depression is now, research suggests that depression is driven by inflammation, or maybe possibly worsened by inflammation in the body. Dementia, as well as degenerative brain diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. Mm-hmm. Your bones and joints. And if anybody feels inflammation, this is where it's kind of easier to sometimes pick out. You know, you have inflammation in a joint and it's painful. But osteoarthritis and joint pain, autoimmune diseases. Autoimmune diseases are really driven by inflammation. Inflammation makes them flare up and the symptoms come out. So lupus, multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, and then a lot of your digestive issues like irritable bowel and Crohn's, pretty much a lot of the conditions that we deal with on a daily basis, skin conditions, hay fever, asthma, you know, a lot of these chronic conditions are just pushed along. They're progressed because of this underlying irritation in the body or inflammation.
Okay. And so just to clarify, inflammation is not necessarily causing all of these conditions, but it's not helping. And it, like you said, it's kind of pushing it along or exacerbating the condition.
Right. It may initiate some of these conditions, but more than anything, it's really kind of the underlying driver, kind of that silent driver that's pushing these conditions along and making them progress.
Okay. Okay. So let's talk about what is the relationship between food and inflammation. And I know you have the top 8 anti-inflammatory foods listed in your book, so you could share those with us as well.
Yeah, well, there are certain things, irritants that bother the body that can trigger inflammation. And there's a wide variety. It's not just food, but food is a key one. And food is one that we have some control over. Mm. So some of your top food inflamers are going to be like refined foods that trigger a hot, that have a high glycemic index, added sugars, fried foods, saturated fats, processed foods, just with the extra chemicals and additives, and you know, all the things that aren't naturally in food. Artificial sweeteners, a high omega-6 to omega-3 intake, high fat meats and processed meats, and then an excess, really, of almost anything, an excess of alcohol, an excess of caffeine, an excess of calories, or an excess of carbs can trigger inflammation or help inflammation kind of grow and progress, which is then going to help those conditions or symptoms progress.
Okay. So, and I know in your book, in both of your books, there's a lot of recipes and we're going to talk about that, but there's a lot of other information in the books as well. And as I mentioned earlier, the Mediterranean diet is one example of an anti-inflammation diet. So Serena, I'd like you to jump in here. You know, the Mediterranean diet is not new to us. We've heard about it for years. But I think there's a lot of people who don't really understand what it is, or maybe some common misperceptions that you could kind of dispel for us and kind of give us an overview of what it is overall, maybe what the health benefits are that are kind of in line with what we've been discussing.
Sure. So Deanna and I like to say, she is my co-author for the book as well, and we like to say that we're two dietitians who love food as much as you do. And while we talk about the Mediterranean diet, we don't talk about how it's a diet. Mm. We talk about how it's more of a lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's sort of important for people to remember that it's not just the food, it's the overall lifestyle that we have seen. And it has been in research study after research study coming out of people who eat a certain way in the countries that surround the Mediterranean diet. But then also that pattern of food that those people eat has certain health benefits, which I think Carolyn will talk about some of those top anti-inflammation foods. All of those together of this pattern of food along with the lifestyle. And when I say the lifestyle, I mean things like literally sitting down with family and friends and enjoying a meal, mm-hmm. slowing down and enjoying your food. And using up the food and throwing out less. I mean, all of that is sort of old, but it's new again. But it's something that is, again, part of that lifestyle of the Mediterranean diet. But it is an overall diet that generally includes plentiful vegetables, omega-3 rich fishes, whole grains, definitely olive oil. And one of the surprising things that I found while researching the Mediterranean diet is it's not just olive oil, it's also olives. Mm-hmm. People in Mediterranean regions eat olives every single day, but it's also spices and lots of fresh herbs, which are high in antioxidants, fermented dairy foods. And these things all together make up generally the Mediterranean diet. It's a high fat diet, but it's also or a higher fat diet. And when I say higher fat, there's been research studies that have looked at comparing the Mediterranean diet, which is a higher fat diet, with lower fat diets. And generally, that's when we find that there is less diabetes and some better outcomes in terms of cardiovascular disease. Mm-hmm. Also, a couple of the misconceptions that people may have are that it is a diet just for, quote, old people. And you might define old people in whatever way you choose, depending on how old you actually happen to be.
Right.
But what I have also found is that there is a lot of benefits for the whole family. Mm. And so for Deanna and I, it was sort of the way that we ended up feeding our family. And then we were like, wow, this is the Mediterranean diet. And that was what really inspired us to write the cookbooks. And specific studies around especially moms who eat the Mediterranean diet while they're pregnant and even children who eat the Mediterranean diet have some protective effects against asthma and wheezing and other breathing problems. So I like to say it's a diet for the entire family, mm-hmm. and It's also super budget friendly, which in this time is really something that we can, I think, all get behind. Mm-hmm. We have a giant pantry list of foods that are super budget friendly in the Mediterranean diet in our book. It's things like canned vegetables, canned beans, canned fruits, even.
Love it.
Canned fish, canned tuna, as well as frozen. So all of the frozen vegetables, all of the, even especially frozen fish. Mm-hmm. And we can probably talk about that a little bit later, but it's really things that you probably already have in your pantry. So it's not like you have to go out and buy a whole bunch of olive oil and red wine. That can be part of the Mediterranean diet, but it's really the more the pattern of those sort of pantry-like foods that make up the Mediterranean diet.
I love that. Yes, because I think the Mediterranean diet does appear to be expensive. And I love the fact that you're bringing in the budget-friendly aspect and the family-friendly aspect. We'll go back to Carolyn because I realize, yeah, we didn't get to the top 8 anti-inflammatory foods that you have listed in your book. So I'd love for you to share those.
When I started writing Meals That Heal, I really just dug into the research. There was no main resource to go to. So I sat in a pile of probably 300, 400 studies and just kind of immersed myself in it. And there were certain foods that kept popping up over and over and over again. I boiled those down to 8 in the book, but there were 3. I'll start with the first 3 because these are the ones that really we have seen the strong research suggests have the strongest anti-inflammatory effects in the body. And that's leafy greens, berries, and cruciferous vegetables. Mm-hmm. And when people ask what to focus on, what do I need to eat? I say, just get more greens, berries, and cruciferous vegetables. Because mm-hmm. it's so, the research is just so strong in regard to those. And we usually all need more of those anyway. Mm-hmm. And other anti-inflammatory would be olive oil. And olive oil actually has a compound called oleocanthal, which has a slightly anti-inflammatory effect in the body. But then a healthy fat intake is also recommended. Fatty fish. So this is primarily for the omega-3s. They are one of the most powerful anti-inflammatory nutrients or compounds in the body. And most of us don't get enough of those. Green tea, nuts and seeds. And then just created this category, which I called gut health promoters. The gut is so tied into inflammation. So eating foods that will really help nourish your gut, either maintain its health or maybe slowly build its health. So your cultured and fermented foods, of course, and then like your prebiotic with vegetables and produce and those types of foods.
Great. Thank you. Yeah. And I know we're going to talk more about, as we keep saying, the recipes and what's in your books, because it's more than recipes. So let's talk about the healthy kitchen hacks, Serena. Not only is that something that you and Deanna have been talking about for 5 years or more, that's actually something that you include with each recipe in the book. And I think you have some sort of like starter ideas for us, or it's like some takeaways for some healthy kitchen hacks that can maybe help simplify the Mediterranean diet and lifestyle. So would you like to share those with us?
Sure. So there are not only 125 recipes in the book, but as you said, there's 125 healthy kitchen hacks. So there's one with every single recipe. But the ones that we probably use the most often throughout the book are these 5 that I'm going to share with you really quick here. And one of them, as I mentioned a little bit before, is about herbs. So we say use cupfuls of herbs instead of tablespoons of herbs. And when you do that, they're not only cheap and packed with nutrition, but it also helps use them up so that they don't become food waste. So if you're using a tablespoon of herbs here and there in a few recipes, it's going to take you a while to get through that bunch of herbs, which again are very inexpensive, usually around $1 or so for parsley, cilantro. Sometimes basil might be a little bit more, but the ones that we use a lot are parsley and cilantro. They're dark green and they can really punch up just the freshness of pretty much anything that you throw it on.
So that would be the fresh herbs.
Yes, good point. Yes. So the fresh herbs. you know, it's usually about a dollar for a bunch of parsley or a bunch of cilantro, and just use those as a salad or toss them into a stew at the end or put them on the top of a bowl of canned soup. And they really just up the antioxidants and the freshness. Secondly, would be always add acid. So before reaching for the salt shaker, add a tablespoon of lemon juice or any sort of vinegar that you happen to have on hand. So whether it's just rice wine vinegar or whether it's balsamic or whether it's apple cider, or even if it's a little bit of white vinegar too, just adding a tablespoon to pretty much anything and it will just punch it up and make it, I like to say it will make it sparkle a little bit. And if it just needs something else, try a little bit of acid before you reach for the salt shaker. So again, that's salad dressings. I even added a lot to Botan salad dressings because it helps decrease the calories a little bit, but it also just adds more of a punch to it where maybe you might not have to use quite as much and it just makes it taste fresher. Also in soups and stews, mashed potatoes, any vegetable that you're cooking, again, just before you add the salt, try a little bit of acid first.
Okay.
Thirdly, don't peel your fruits or vegetables, because what happens is when you peel it, you are actually peeling off the highest percentage of those antioxidants, because right under the peel is where the plant has those chemicals and components that help fight disease. So if a bug attacks the plant, they're going to fight it off with whatever's right below the skin. Same with disease. It's going to fight it off. So if you're peeling your vegetables and your fruits, you're losing that. And so that's everything from potatoes and sweet potatoes and beets to fruits. So leave those peels on. And you can find some ways to, you know, whether you just bake it in the skin and mix in, you know, part of the skins in your mashed potatoes. You don't have to use all of them, but, you know, mix into your mashed potatoes part of those skins or whatever fruit or vegetable you're using. I talked about this earlier about slowing down and enjoying your meals with families and friends, but that really can have health benefits in terms of satiety and improved mental health. And it really is a true component of the Mediterranean diet. And then lastly, what people also don't realize, it's sort of a misconception that, and I hear this all the time lately. I was giving a talk just the other day about the Mediterranean diet, and someone emailed me afterwards and said, "You mean I can eat pasta now?" Yes, pasta is absolutely a healthy component of the Mediterranean diet. The Mediterranean diet is high in carbohydrates, including whole grains, but also pasta is in practically every region of the Mediterranean. And the trick with pasta, and this is my healthy kitchen hack, is do not overcook it. Because if you overcook the pasta, what happens is it becomes a little bit more mushy. And so that cell structure that makes up the pasta lets the water in. And so it becomes mushy and it's actually digested much quicker and it increases the glycemic index of the pasta. So if you cook your pasta to just al dente, which is basically what they say on the package of the pasta, it will stay at a lower glycemic index and it will actually keep you fuller longer, not increase the blood sugar quite so much or quite so spiked, and will keep the body processing that pasta for quite some time and will keep you full.
I keep telling my husband, don't overcook the pasta. Al dente, please. No mushy pasta. So now there's a health reason for that. Okay.
That's right.
Well, thank you for sharing those. And Carolyn, your book has a lot of different things besides the recipes. And one of the things that I love, I call them builders. Like you have like a salad builder and a snack builder. You don't call them that, but it's basically like whether it's a chart or a graph that kind of gives you ideas for things to create different types of variety of salads or variety of snacks and so on. That was one of the favorite things I saw in your book. But would you like to tell us about what else is in your book and maybe touch on some of the menus for healing, an overview of what that might be?
Yeah. And you mentioned the builders. That's a good name for them. You know, I realized a lot of my favorite meals that I eat at home are ones where I just grab a little of this and a little of that and kind of whatever's in the refrigerator. And I realized that That feels real natural to me, but it doesn't to a lot of people. Mm-hmm. So I created the builders, as you referred to them, to kind of help people, to guide them in their creativity when they're pulling, you know, a grain bowl together or a salad bowl together using what they have on hand. Mm-hmm. You know, another thing that's in my book that I made a real point to include is store-bought items mm-hmm. and how to pick healthier ones. And I think it's in part because I'm always trying to get out of cooking a little. I love cooking and I love food. I mean, that's how I got into this profession, but it just stays in my life with a 14-year-old and a 10-year-old and work. You know, it's cooking right now is more of something on my to-do list. I know it'll, you know, that will change, but I need shortcuts just like everybody else. Mm-hmm. So I made a point, you know, tips on how to buy a healthy bottled salad dressing. There are a lot of them out there now. We didn't used to have many options. Mm-hmm. Pantry staples like pre-cooked whole grains that you can buy now, you know, leafy greens that are already washed, tricks like that, because I rely on those kind of things to help me get dinner on the table. So I really tried to give people some guidelines, you know, even when it comes to buying snacks, what to look for, condiments, that type of thing, just to try to make it real, because I don't cook everything from scratch, mm-hmm. And I'm certainly not going to. And I know other people, most people aren't. So I want to make it easy for people.
Great.
The other thing that I have in the back are some disease management guides. What I realized when going through the research is the underlying anti-inflammatory diet, you know, is the same for all conditions, but what started jumping out at me in the research is that there were certain things that were more effective for certain disease conditions. So I have some quick guides where it says these are the essential focus areas. These are, you know, because sometimes it can be a lot for people to take in. Mm. So if you're trying to prevent or manage type 2 diabetes, I've got, you know, here's where to focus first. Mm. And then here's some additional considerations once you've got that. And I do that for cancer prevention and heart health, brain health, joint health, and then autoimmune conditions to try to help people there.
Great. I also like to ask any cookbook authors who are on my podcast if they would like to tell us about one of their favorite recipes in the book. And I know, Serena, you already gave a shout out to me before the show about your tahini brownies. So I have no idea what that would taste like, but I want you to tell us about that or maybe another favorite recipe. And then same with you, Carolyn.
Sure. So the tahini brownies are basically a dark chocolate brownie made with cocoa powder. And then you swirl in some tahini paste, which is basically, instead of peanut butter, it would be a sesame seed butter. Mm. And so it leads to a rich, nutty taste. And you use it in the brownies, and then you also use it in the frosting on top. And by the way, if you don't happen to have tahini in your pantry, you could just use peanut butter. So they could be peanut butter brownies too as well. And then I guess one more shout out, besides the whole entire chapter on pasta and the entire chapter on pizza, which we cook all the time in my house, would be the skillet shrimp with tomatoes and feta. Mm. So maybe you've seen how Instagram and TikTok have sort of blown up with the roasted tomatoes and feta in the dish that becomes sort of like a dip. Mm-hmm. Well, we were testing this recipe like 2 years ago with all of our testers. We had an army of recipe testers, around 40 of them from around the country, that tested our recipes and told us, this is too fussy, or this is just not easy enough to cook. Mm-hmm. You need to change it. And so we did. And so we listened to them. So all of the recipes haven't just been tested by ourselves, but they've also been tested by our recipe testers. So not only was one of this a favorite one with the recipe testers, this skillet shrimp with tomatoes and feta is one of both Deanna and my favorite recipes as well. And it's basically that block of feta surrounded by some quickly cooked shrimp and grape tomatoes.
Mm, sounds delicious. Thank you. And Carolyn, what about any favorite recipes you want to describe for us?
Yeah, well, one is a dessert, and it's the peanut butter chocolate chip cookie dough bites. Mm. And I'll be honest, when I was developing this recipe, I thought, this isn't going to be any good. Why am I even testing this? Because it uses chickpeas as kind of your dough, if you want to call it that, base. Mm. But once I kind of got in there and tweaked it, it is amazing. And I tell people, you know, I try to not tell people what's in it before they try it, because they love it. And then they're like, what's in it? But they are amazing. And I was so just kind of surprised, but thrilled with how they turned out. And you can keep them in the freezer and just grab one when you need it. Then the Greek spaghetti squash toss is real popular among people, as well as the taco zoodle skillet. The taco zoodle skillet is a good family one. It's a good, easy introduction for maybe family members who aren't sure about veggie noodles. You know, everybody loves taco night. And so this is a kind of a good way, an easy way to introduce it. And it uses lean ground beef, but you use just like 3/4 of a pound. So you're just using a little bit for some flavor in there.
Oh, those all sound delicious. I wanted to also ask you both where people can find out more information about you and your books online. And if there's any recipes either, you know, from those books or other recipes that you have that people can find online and try before getting your book. And of course, I'll have all the links to all of this in my show notes at soundbitesrd.com. But I'd love for you both to kind of share your website and your social media handles.
This is Serena. Main place is at the teaspoonofspice.com website. And there's information there on how to find my book, Easy Everyday Mediterranean Diet Cookbook, as well as several of the recipes that started out there. It's the blog that I do with Deanna, and then they made it into the cookbook. And then you can also find me on Instagram at TSP Curry, and on Twitter also there. And then on Facebook, on the Teaspoon of Spice Facebook page, Deanna and I do Facebook Lives every Thursday at 11:30 a.m. Central Time, where we share a lot of our healthy kitchen hacks, our recipes, recipes from the book, recipes from the blog, and just fun stuff that we're happy if you join and cook along or just hang out and pick up some tips here and there.
I love watching you guys cook together, even if you're not in the same room. It's so much fun.
Thank you.
And Carolyn?
Yeah, so you can visit my website, which is carolynwilliamsrd.com, to find more of my recipes. And it's where I share articles that I've written, as well as my book. But you can also find Meals That Heal at pretty much any of your major book retailers, as well as Amazon. Amazon's usually the least expensive and the quickest, but you can find it all there, as well as my Instagram and Facebook. My Instagram is realfoodreallife_RD.
Excellent. Thank you. And Serena had shared these healthy kitchen hack tips, takeaway tips for us. And so, Carolyn, I wanted to know if you had any kind of takeaway parting advice for us to kind of, you know, what are some things that we can start doing today?
A lot of times people want to know, what do I need to avoid? What do I need to cut out? And I try to start people by getting them to focus on what they can add. Start there. Makes for a lot more pleasant experience, but focus on what you can add, because you need those cruciferous vegetables, those berries, those leafy greens. Focus on getting more of those and good healthy fats and omega-3s. And then once you've kind of gotten used to that, gotten the hang of that or doing some of that, then focus on, okay, these are some things that I need to work on reducing or trying to eliminate from my diet. Focus on what you can add at first. My other tip that I give people for when they are grocery shopping is just kind of a general tip that I use, like when I'm buying like a jar of spaghetti sauce or salad dressing, is I look at the ingredients. And I look to see if I were making the spaghetti sauce at home from scratch, which I'm not, but if I were, I want to see that the ingredients in the ingredient list are the same as what I might find in a recipe. I want to see tomatoes. I want to see basil. I want to see garlic. I want to see olive oil. I don't want to see things I can't pronounce. And the same thing for a salad dressing. And that really kind of helps you kind of hone down a good bit on whether this is a healthier item or maybe a not so healthy item.
Great. I also know that, you know, when it comes to, you know, we talk about the diet, but also lifestyle. Carolyn, there's something that you talk to people about that you think is almost as important as the food. Do you want to share that?
Yes, sleep. You know, I think we tend to think of sleep as indulgent. But gosh, there is so much research out now just showing how much we need sleep and how much we can't change things, or our body can't heal, or, you know, inflammation levels can't decline if we aren't getting adequate restful sleep. And that's different amounts for everybody, but we just need regular, adequate, restful sleep.
Yeah, I love that. It's so important. Well, thank you both so much for coming on the show and collaborating with this inflammation and anti-inflammation diet conversation. Both of your books are just beautiful. The photos, the recipes look great. I haven't tried them yet, but I plan to. So I'll have to circle back and mention that on a future episode. But thank you so much for coming on the show and talking about this great topic.
Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa.
All right. And for everybody listening, as always, enjoy your food with health in mind. Till next time.
For more information, visit soundbitesrd.com. Music by Dave Burke, produced by JAG and Detroit Podcasts.